Your Berks Craftsmen on BCTV is supported by the Kutztown Folk Festival and by the Reading Berks Guild of Craftsmen. BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.
Hi, good evening, and welcome to tonight's edition of Your Berks Craftsmen. I am Kay Bennecoff, your host, and we are going to do a little bird watching this evening. No, you don't have to leave the comfort of your chair. Thanks to Zoom again, we are going to be flying into the studio of Mr. Dick Snyder, a bird carver. So he's in his natural habitat this evening, and he is going to take us into the world, like I said, of bird carving. Hi, Dick. How are you?
Hi, Kay. How are you?
I am very well, thank you. Thanks for inviting us into your studio tonight. We are so pleased to be here.
Welcome. Glad to have you.
Okay. Dick is one of our newer members of the Reading Berks Guild of Craftsmen. I believe you got juried last year with us.
Correct.
And he was gracious enough, like I said, to invite us into the studio. And thanks to the COVID-19, we have been able to go into a few studios over this past year. So there's very little to be thankful for COVID-19, but it has been able to bring us to that. Okay. Because we wouldn't have been able to do this before, you know. Mm-hmm. And your studio, and like I said, you're in your natural habitat of carving there.
Okay. Correct.
Okay. Dick, why don't you just kind of tell us how you got started in this fascinating?
Okay. I've been doing it a little over 30 years, Kay, and I actually got started kind of to my background of hunting. I always liked hunting ducks and geese and so forth, and I was always kind of intrigued by duck decoys and things like that, and I actually have always spent time in Canada every summer, unfortunately not this summer, but other summers I have, and I bought a few decoys from people and so on and so forth. And I always kind of secretly wanted to give it a try. So when I was up on vacation the one year, I carved my very first little duck. And I actually have it with you. You can see it's a beauty. It's got some googly eyes and so forth. It was just done with a penknife and some rough paint. And that was where it all began. And actually, my parents were up on vacation. And one of their friends told me about a gentleman who had previously taught classes, was no longer teaching them, but still sold supplies for carving and books and so forth. So I went over and met him and was just absolutely blown away at the quality of the work that he could do and his students could do. And so I bought a few things and a couple books, and about 3 months after I started, my father had already retired, and he was looking for something else to do other than just play golf. And he thought, you know, that really looks kind of like fun. It looks kind of neat. So he went with me one Saturday and just got hooked on it. So we kind of started together, and where we live, there wasn't anyone really in this area to teach us. Uh-huh. So we bought some books and, you know, a few basic tools to get started. And we kind of taught each other, you know, between reading the books and looking at each other's work and, you know, kind of critiquing it and so forth. So we kind of learned together.
Mm-hmm. Now, let me just go back just one short time about that small decoy that you did. You said you did. Now, did you do that when you were up in Canada then?
I did. Yeah. I carved it up in Canada with a pocket knife.
Right.
And then when I got home, I just got some paint and painted it. And I bought a pair of eyes at a hobby store. And that was number one.
I just think that is so good to show our viewers at home, you know, that you just picked it up and did it, you, just because you wanted to do it.
And that's exactly how I started, correct.
That's awesome. Okay, so then fast forward, okay, you and your dad then, you know, then got together. This is so cool too, that you and your dad started this together.
Yep.
And you don't take pictures. I mean, you use books as your reference.
We learned to carve basically from reading directions from other people that were carvers and how they did it and so forth, you know, just to get the basics. Mm-hmm. And of course, the world's a little different now as far as reference material than it was 30 years ago. If you look around my shop, I have, you know, shelves full of books and on birds and plants and all kinds of things. But it's so critical to have that reference material, those photos and the information to be able to, you know, try to recreate, you know, something like a bird and something like the habitat that the bird is in. So,
mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a critical point. We'll get into that a little later as far as when you do your judging, when you're judged, when you enter a competition and everything. So, yeah. So your background then of going to Canada for all those years certainly, you know, inspired you and you were one in nature.
Correct. And I mean, you see birds that I don't normally see as frequently around here. I mean, I'm on a lake and I see ospreys and I see loons and I see kingfishers. You know, I mean, they're just everywhere. And I mean, it is kind of inspiring, you know, not that I don't see birds here, but you just feel a little bit closer to nature when you're there. So,
well, because you are.
Yeah, exactly. You're correct.
Okay. So let's see. You and you didn't have any art ability. Okay, that's another thing I need to emphasize on here, because that little decoy is really good.
I did take a try at painting when I was in my early 20s. I tried a little bit of doing watercolor work. Okay. And I was very frustrated with it because, and I'm not a watercolor artist. I use acrylics in my shop, but I found it to be very hard to know when you had enough or not enough on the paper, because once you put it on with watercolors, that's it. Mm-hmm. You know, you've got to know the right time to stop. And I find it so much easier for me to work with the acrylics than with the watercolors. So, so for me, that was my kind of foray into the art world. Uh-huh. And I didn't get into this till about 10 or 12 years later, when I actually tried doing something different. And this is what I tried.
Mm-hmm. Well, let me just ask you this then. Would watercolor even be a consideration to paint this kind of bird?
Well, I mean, for bird carving, people are either using acrylic paints or they're using oil colors. Mm-hmm. Oil colors blend beautifully, where acrylics are harder to. I've never really tried the oil colors for flat art or for birds. I have several friends that do. Mm-hmm. I just find the acrylics to be an easier medium for me to work with for my carving. So, and the other issue is that if you look in nature at birds, with very few exceptions, their birds are not shiny. They're really kind of they're pretty, but they're dull. Mm-hmm. And they make special acrylic paints that are matte finish. And that's what I tend to use. There are times, as I said, that you want a bird to have that glossy look. Mm-hmm. You know, there are several birds that have kind of an iridescent colors in them. You know, when you think about the head of a wood duck, mm-hmm. or you think about a ruby-throated hummingbird, that little area underneath the throat and across the back, they're shiny, but they're a different type of shiny. So I use the acrylics that I can use that are matte to get the texture and the appearance of what I want for my final product.
Sure, because you are trying to make it look just like it were, you know.
Correct.
You just don't have the singing part down, you know.
I don't have that down. No, you're absolutely right. I haven't figured that out.
I didn't see his little beak move either.
Nope.
Okay. If you know, that's great. Okay. Well, do you know what? Let's get started. Okay.
All right. You want me to take you from beginning to end half here? Okay.
Carving 101, right, Dick?
Okay.
We'll start at the end.
Yeah, we'll show them then at the end. These are what I start with. This is what we call a pattern. And if you'll notice, there's two views, a side view and a top view. And this is not my pattern. This is a friend of mine's pattern.
Oh, okay.
But when you start a bird, you have to know what your bird is going to look like. And this is what I'm using for right now. When I do birds for competition, what I many times will do is I will take pictures off the internet and blow them up or shrink them down to whatever size I want, look for the views I want, match them up, and then I'll use them to cut my birds out, and I'll use them as my reference, along with a lot of other pictures for when I'm working on a bird. So I use this, and what this helps me create is this. And that is what you start with, and you'll notice that I've drawn with a pencil the center of the bird.
Do you want to hold that up a little more, Dick?
Sure.
There we go. Okay.
And you can see the top and you can see the bottom. And that's what we actually start with. Now, we'll go work on this in just a minute, but I want to kind of show you then the progress. This is a carved bird. This would be ready to seal and paint. If you can see that, I don't know how well you can see the detail on that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
This was one of my competition pieces for this year that, since we didn't have any shows, we never competed.
Aww.
So, but this was one of my pieces, and everything here I had to make. The branch is not real. It is made out of brass and steel. The bird's feet are made. I mean, everything you see is something that I had to create. The block of wood, that's Mother Nature created that. The base, but everything else, you know, I cut it to shape, but everything else is something that I made. When we do birds, we're not only doing life-size birds, but for competitions, we also do miniature birds. So I don't know how well you can see that, mm-hmm. but that's a miniature Carolina wren, just like that bird.
Okay, when you say miniature, you mean the bird itself is tiny?
Here's my finger, right. Okay. And there's the bird. Oh,
okay, that's a great comparison.
You can see how small it is. When you do competitions in the miniature category, the bird has to be 50% or smaller.
Okay.
Now, where it gets interesting is, if you're doing a 50% bald eagle, it's still going to be humongous. If you do a 50% chickadee or a goldfinch, you're talking about something very tiny.
Wow.
So they have different categories when you compete at the world show. Mm-hmm. In local shows, they basically just have miniature birds. So you're kind of competing against all the miniature birds. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of what we're trying to do. We're trying to compete in one of those genres, mm-hmm. so to speak. Either miniature or life-size pieces. So, okay. So if having said that, do you want to get started?
Yes.
You want to see what I do?
Yes. Yeah. Now, one question then you brought that up. So when a person starting out would probably want to do a life-size bird, right? Because
it's much easier.
Miniature.
Correct.
More difficult.
When I started, my dad and I started doing ducks because that's what was popular and that's what everybody did. The problem with ducks are they're a real commitment from a time standpoint. There's a lot of work involved, and it's a big, big, big piece of wood you're working with. After probably maybe 4 or 5 years of carving ducks, we decided we'd try songbirds, and I actually found a book that had been put out by a very famous world champion carver on carving miniature birds. And that just turned my life around when I found that. And I just was always have been fascinated with miniature birds. I love doing them all. The miniatures kind of hold a special place in my heart. I just kind of really enjoy doing them.
Okay.
All right. Now I'll also show you this. I teach classes, and this is actually a class bird I'm working on. And you can see I've done some work on it. I've rough shaped it. You can see how nice and round it is. This is probably one of the things that beginning carvers struggle with the most, is trying to get birds round. They have a tendency to leave them square, just like I did on my first bird. I left it square. But you can see I've done some things. I've kind of roughed in the head. I've put the where the eyes are going to be. I've taken one of the wings, and I've actually carved and burned it in so you can see what the wing will look like.
Okay.
This one I've simply drawn on, and I'm going to show you how I do that in a couple of minutes.
Okay.
I've also done the tail, and you can see I've done the belly. One thing you'll notice is I use different tools for different effects, different appearances. When I do the wings, when you look at the wings on the bird, they're what I call hard feathers. They're hard and fast. They look, you know, very sleek. And that's what they are. They're their flight feathers. And when you, so I want to make them look just like the birds on a feather's wing. When you get into the head and the cape, which is the area around the neck, and then you move into the belly, it's much softer appearance. So what, and again, I don't know how well you can see that.
Yeah.
But what I tried to do is to make some, what I call lumps and bumps, some areas where these different groups of feathers kind of overlap each other or puff out a little bit, and you're trying to make them look light and airy. I mean, that's really what the idea is. So, and I'll show you how I do that. So what I do when I start, I will take this bird, and I'm going to use, I use a dust collector. I'm going to try to keep it on a very low speed, so it doesn't make noise and you can hear me over it.
Okay.
I'll take my glasses off and I'll put some safety glasses on. Can you hear me okay over that noise?
Yep, we're fine.
Okay.
Yep, all right. We're good. So if we can get in, on your hands there and
we're going to give that a try. When I rough out a bird, I don't do anything fancy. This is called a micromotor. And this is kind of like a fancy Dremel, but it's what it's very much what like your dentist uses when they work on you, or when they
need your sideline dick.
No dental work for me.
Okay,
but, they do different jobs and they run different speeds. I'm going to turn this one on and show you what I'm trying to do. Okay, so my goal here is to try to round this bird. And I'm just going to show you how I do that. And I don't know if you can see what I'm doing.
I do. I see that. And I think everybody can see that. But I have to say, it does sound like a dentist drill.
It does. Yeah, it does. I get a little nervous. I always feel like I'm in the dentist chair when I'm working.
What I
do is I usually will make one mark, okay? And then it will leave two little lines, one on each side of where I was working. If you can see that.
Yes.
And I find that if I go in and I work on one line and then I work on the other line and just take them off, you can see how it's starting to round the bird.
Yeah, you're getting that perfectly, yes.
Correct. And what I'm going to do, I need to work on all four areas. My next step, and I'm not going to do this because I want to show you the burning and the stoning, but my next step would be to lay in where the wings are. And the wings on this bird are dropped. this is an example of the wings that are dropped. This is what you've got to try to achieve.
Okay,
you want. So you've got to carve. Okay. You've got to. When you do this, you're going to lay out with a pencil. I know my wing is going to be dropped down here.
Okay, we can't. Okay, I can't see. There we go. Now I
can see it. Yeah, okay. My wing is actually down, and I have. Let me grab one of these. This is the same pattern, and you can see how the wing is down below the tail. Okay, birds, when you show them in different poses, sometimes the wings will both be on top of the back. Sometimes they'll be crossed, like on this blue jay. This blue jay has the wings crossed, if you can see that.
Okay, yes.
And you can see the wings on this Carolina wren are dropped to the side.
Oh.
So what you want to do is you want to try to put the birds in as many different natural poses as you can. You know, a bird with that's just straight on with its wings straight back is probably the easiest type of bird to do. So when you're doing competitions, you want to try to do something that's a little bit more challenging. Turn the head, cross the wings, drop the wings, you know, something other than just the basics.
Dick, may I ask you a question right here?
Sure.
So are you looking at pictures then?
Yes.
Okay, you're seeing them right now as you're working on this, or?
Correct. I'm using whatever I'm going to use as my basic pattern for carving the bird is what I'm going to use to be getting my pose.
Okay, very good. Okay.
So what I would do is my first cut, and I'll just make a cut for you. I'll show you. My first cut would be to cut in where this wing goes. And again, I'm just using this sander. Cut that in, and I would do the same thing on the other side. And then I can start rounding the belly on this side, just like I did the other side. Okay?
Yep.
And once I have the bird in a very rough shape, the round shape, and I'm going to switch to another bird, and I'm going to show you how I take it to the next steps.
Okay.
All right. So once I have the bird roughed out, and I have the wings laid in, and the stomach rounded, and the back rounded, and I'm going to switch to a different bird.
Okay.
I'm going to switch to the blue jay. And I'll show you doing this first, and then we'll do some burning. I'm just going to switch a bit here.
Yep, that's fine. The miracle of television, you know, we fast-forwarded, and now we have.
Correct. So I'm going to put the speed up on this a little bit, and I'm going to use a round ball, a round diamond ball. You can see that?
Oh, yes. Okay, so you
change that. And what I'm going to do, I'm going to form a couple of feather groups here. And I'm just going to do a couple of them here for you, just to show you. So the next step you've got to do is you've got to smooth this out. And all I'm doing is taking some of the wood away on the underside, the downward side of where I cut my feather in. Okay?
Yeah. So I see you're holding that dremel much like you hold a pencil.
I hold it that way, and if you'll watch my hands, you'll notice that I always anchor my finger. And I do that whether I'm wood burning, or whether I'm doing this, or whether I'm painting. I always anchor my finger. It helps you to hold whatever you're working on and to hold the tool much more steady.
Have good control, you have a better control.
And that's exactly what it's for. It's for control.
Very interesting.
Okay.
Yeah.
And I'm just gonna, like I said, I have some other things I want to show you, so I'm gonna try not to spend too much time on this.
That's fine.
But I'll show you what I do next. So
I've kind of laid in a couple feathers. I don't have it as smooth as I would like it to be, but I'm gonna take you to the next step anyway and show you how I do this. I use something called a red ceramic stick, and it is actually a ceramic material, if you can see that.
Okay.
It's very hard, and it holds an edge.
Yeah.
It holds an edge. So what I'm gonna do when I start is I'm gonna sharpen it. Just put it down flat, so I have a nice sharp edge. In order to do these feathers, okay?
Okay.
And if you can follow me, I try to want to make this look like a fan shape.
Okay, maybe if Kathy can back it up a little. There we go. That's good.
And again, I'm doing this kind of in a different way than I would normally do it. So I'm not being as precise with my lines.
Sure, but you're trying to teach us here or
I'm
show us.
I'm trying to show you, yes. Correct.
Showing us, yes.
Correct. And I'm trying to make them look as much like the fan shape of a real feather. If you look at this side, the one side I've already done, you can see how I've kind of achieved that fan shape.
Mm-hmm.
With everything bending like that. So that's what I would do on here. Also, as with anything else, we have our own names for different parts of the bird. These are undertail coverts, they call them.
Okay.
I have to point out, I don't want to show you all the different parts of the wing, but I do have to show you this little area right here, because it's my favorite, these little feathers right here. Mm-hmm. It's called the Alula, and that's my favorite.
And why?
It's because of the name, Alula.
Gotcha.
All right. So now I'm going to show you the next part. Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
So I'm going to use that for the areas where I want it to be soft and fluffy. And then I'm going to use, and this is not like the wood burners of old. This is a wood burner that turns on and cools off very, very quickly.
Okay.
And I'm using a special type of a bit, if you can, or a burner, if you can see, you notice it's bent.
I do see that, yes.
Okay, and that's not a mistake.
Okay.
I do that with them on purpose. And what I'm going to do, and I'm going to cheat, I'm going to put on a magnifier just to help me see better.
Okay.
And if you can watch my hand.
Okay.
And again, see, I've got my finger planted.
Okay, if you can just get that a little, there we go. Okay, now we can.
And I'm going to turn the heat down a little bit. And.
Oh, yeah.
This is how I burn a feather in. We'll burn a couple, and then I'll show you how I actually put the centers in them and burn them.
May I ask another question here, Dick? Maybe some of us.
As many as you like, Kay.
Okay, maybe if. Is this similar to the wood burning kits that we used to get when we were kids?
No, it's totally different.
Totally
this,
different. Okay.
Those you would plug in and they would take forever to heat up and cool down. This heats up in a matter of seconds and cools down. Now, I just turned this off. It will probably be 15 or 20 seconds before I can touch that tip.
Okay.
So very, very quick.
Yeah.
So what I'm going to show you again, as I said, I'm trying to take you through the steps without getting into too much detail, but.
Yeah, no, this is interesting.
I have here three feathers that I just did. And these feathers, because of their positioning on the bird, you would see the center stem. Some of these feathers, when you get down in here, are underneath of other feathers. They're stacked on top of each other. And you don't see the center portion of the feather. Because, you know, a feather has obviously two sides and a stem in the center. So what I do is I will burn, that would be helpful if I turn the heat on, and it'll only take a few seconds to do. Okay, and the heat's coming on.
Mm-hmm.
And you'll notice I'm drawing two parallel lines,
mm-hmm.
as close together as I can get them. And that gives you your stem. That's mm-hmm. your center. So the barbs on this side of the feather are going to be going this way, and mm-hmm. the barbs on that side of the feather are going to be going the other way. But to make it more challenging, when you look at a real feather, the barbs bend back. They're not straight. And I don't know if you can see that.
Mm-hmm.
And the goal is to get them as close together as you can.
Well, I think we can learn a lot about the intricacy of their wings, you know, from this as well. And
yeah.
This is what makes them fly.
Exactly. And again, I'm not going to try to do too much. I'm just trying to show you a little bit about it. I'll do a little bit on the other side just to show you.
Mm-hmm.
And you can see, I have to, again, I'm trying to make sure that those barbs bend. Because mm-hmm. when you look at the real feather, they come back.
Yes.
To the point. Okay?
Yes, very good. Thank you.
You can see that? And again, the under tail, and you'll notice that the feathers on the top of the tail are totally different than the feathers underneath. Mm-hmm. You're only seeing the top maybe 6 or 8 feathers here. You're seeing the rest of the feathers here. There are many more feathers than what you see when you look at a tail. You only see very few of them. And an exception to that would be if you see a male turkey strutting, many times they'll have their tail fanned out. And you can actually see all the feathers.
Right.
So with songbirds, the only ones you ever really see them all the feathers on that show them is when you're watching a hummingbird feeding, and they have the tail fanned out and everything else as part of their stabilization when they're flying. So
yeah.
All right. How's that look?
It looks great. Okay. I have your bird that, you know, here, right here. And when you're showing this, I'm kind of looking here and going, oh, yes, I see all of this. You know, it's we're learning a lesson in aerodynamics as well.
Well, you know, it's funny when you learn to carve, you have to learn so much about the bird and the bird anatomy,
right.
You know, and they're really incredible creatures. They really are. So yeah, they're amazing. Yeah. So I you know, obviously I feed them all the time. I just love just sitting out watching them. So,
sure.
All right, now I'm going to move over and do a few minutes of painting, not too long, because I want to come back then and do some show you how I make a foot and how I make some habitat.
Okay.
So yeah. we're gonna move across the room just for a few minutes to show you a little bit about painting.
Okay.
This is my painting studio part of my room.
Okay.
Okay, and this is a gray-faced screech owl that I'm working on. I wanted to do one with a sleepy eye look. So hopefully you guys can see that, the sleepy eye look.
Okay, is this a 50%, you know, is this a miniature?
No, this is the life-size.
This is
the life-size screech owl.
Okay.
And you'll notice in front of me, there's a red phase and a gray phase. Gray phase is much harder to paint. That's what I'm trying. So. What I would do is, again, I'm not going to spend a ton of time on painting because it takes so long in between to try to let it dry and so forth. These are what I use. I use a mixture of different brands. What I'm using right now is Liquitex acrylic gouache. And the nice thing I like about these are matte finish. So I'm going to put a little bit of that out. And I'm just going to show you a wash. I got out two browns. I got out burn umber and raw umber. They're the two browns that I use more than any others. Mm-hmm. The raw umber is more of a yellowish tint to it.
Okay.
The burn umber is more of a reddish tint to it. So I'm going to use a little bit of the burn umber just to mix with this. Very, very rarely do I ever use a solid color. The only exception would be when I'm doing, putting gesso on the bird. When I do a bird, when I finish carving it and stoning it, and you can see, you'll probably see a lot of the same marks you saw on the other birds, I seal it
to keep the water and the paint from getting in. If it gets into the wood, it will raise the grain and I'll lose all these marks that I put in, all these burning marks and all these what I call stony marks that I put in. It'll all disappear. And so all that texture will be gone.
Oh, wow.
So I make sure I seal it good. And then I put a light coat of gesso on it, which is just, this is gesso. It's almost like titanium white paint, but it's thicker. I water it down and I paint it all over the bird. Does two things. Number one, I start with a uniform color for painting. Number two, because it's a whitish color underneath, it helps the light reflect back out and help show off your paints.
Okay.
So I'm gonna just put a little bit on here, just take a minute or two and put a little bit on. And I'm making kind of a brownish gray color, kind of a medium gray.
Mm-hmm.
And when I put washes on, I really, really thin the paint down. I don't want to take the two colors and just put them on straight. What that will do is it will have a tendency to want to block all the work I did. The paint will get in and fill it up. So when I have new students, they're sometimes frustrated at painting because they think they're just going to sit down and, you know, go boom, 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 and the bird's going to be painted. And sometimes it takes as long to paint a bird as it does to carve. So here I'm actually putting what I call a wash on.
Mm-hmm.
And you can see I'm kind of following those marks I already put in, burned in, stoned in, whichever. And I'm kind of following them up. And you can see it's not, there's not a whole lot of color to it.
No, no. And the wash, doing the wash helps with the shading. Is that correct?
It does. And by building up the color this way, you almost get a softness to it.
Sure.
And as I said, it doesn't block the work that I've done. It isn't going to fill it up. But it, as I said, my students get frustrated because we may put 10 coats like this on.
Right, yeah.
Of very, very, very thin washes. Now, usually between, I'll use a hairdryer. Not that I need one myself, but I use one for drying the paint. Because it's not real exciting sitting watching paint dry.
No, you and my husband share that same sentiment.
So, exactly. So that is what a thin wash of paint looks like. And you can see some places it might be a little bit more gray.
Right, right.
I can come back in here. And that's the beauty of putting washes on.
Mm-hmm.
Some of the paint's going to go down in some of the grooves that I carved in and kind of putting some shadowing in,
mm-hmm.
Which just adds to the appearance, overall appearance of the owl.
Yeah, so. I would think your students, when they do this then for the first time, no matter what they thought they were going to do, and then when they do this, this is almost like a miracle. It's almost like a surprise, you know.
It's funny. I sometimes on Saturdays have a couple of young boys. Actually, they're not young. The one's 20 now. And the first bird he did was a chickadee.
Uh-huh.
And I told him I wasn't going to use black for the color. I was going to use burn umber and ultramarine blue. And when you mix them together, they give you a very warm black color.
Mm-hmm.
And when he put the first wash on, he said, oh, this is never going to be black. I said, well, you tell me that after you've got about 8 or 10 washes on. When he had the 8 or 10 washes on, he says, you were right. That's black now. I said, correct, but it's not a dark, cold black. It's a very soft, warm black, which is what I was going for. So,
the
bottom line is I don't spend a lot of time putting on straight coats. The exception might be when I'm done the overall bird, and there'll be several different colors on here. I might use an airbrush, which I do use sometimes, or just a paintbrush, to put a super, super thin wash on at the end, just to marry all the colors together, to tone some of the colors that are brighter and to mute it. Because An owl is not a bright bird. I mean, you can see the colors, but they're not bright. It's not like, again, the hummingbird, which has got a lot of iridescence on it and so forth. So, all right, let me grab one thing and I'll meet you back over here to show you something. I just want to show you a couple of different habitats I've done.
Oh, yes. So
this was a gift for a friend of mine in Canada who has to wait now till next year to get it. It's a Baltimore Oriole on a dogwood branch. And nice. You have to make everything.
Yeah, now this is for your competitions. When we, let's just kind of touch on that.
Correct.
The Ward World Championships, right? That correct. You go to
if,
these.
If anybody who's watching this wants to be absolutely, totally amazed, go and look at the Ward Museum, which is part of Salisbury University, and go look at the Ward, WARD World Championship. This was to be our 50th year, and unfortunately, that's going to wait till next year.
Right.
But they have the biggest competition in the world of birds, and I mean, the quality of the work is absolutely incredible. I've been fortunate enough to become friends with many of the world champions, and they're just wonderful people. The quality of the work they do is, you know, head and shoulders above what I do. I'm just in awe of looking at, and if anybody goes and looks, you'll see what I mean. The work is just incredible. I mean, some of these folks are such incredibly talented artists, it's not even funny, but it's definitely worth looking at. It's definitely worth spending some time looking at. So this is a piece that I just did. This is a piece that I just did for a gentleman in Ohio. This was a commissioned piece that I haven't sent to him yet. And this is a bee balm flower, if you can see it.
Yeah.
There's like 75 pieces put into here.
Or hold it up a little bit more. Oh, that's incredible. See, you're also a botanist.
You have to know habitat. If I put a hummingbird in a flower that's indigenous to Africa, there are judges that would call me on that because there are no hummingbirds in Africa.
Yeah.
So they're South America, Central America, North America, Canada. That's where they are. So you have to put them in real habitat that you would see them in.
Yeah. Oh, is Kathy okay there? I hear her coughing. Is she okay?
Oh, no, she's fine.
Okay.
She's fine. Yep. She's just getting over a cold, my grandma. Yeah,
don't want to lose our camera person. But that's... Dick, that's just beautiful.
Well, thank you. And I'm going to kind of take you over here to our habitat shop and show you a little bit about what I do. I don't know how much time I have left, but I want to kind of use it on this.
We have about we're at about 15 minutes or so.
Oh, okay. So I've got some more time left. Okay. Yeah. So this is the start of the bee balm plant.
Oh, okay.
You can see all these individual pieces.
Yes.
And actually, my wife came up with the idea of doing this. You're drawing them on a piece of paper.
Mm-hmm.
And then gluing them. This is what I use to cut the leaves out with. This is called brass shim stock. And I buy it. It's called shim in a can.
Oh, okay.
That's how I buy it.
Okay.
And I would put this on and use some adhesive glue, some spray glue, okay. And then cut them out. And then you can just peel the back off of them. And you can see, I went and grabbed this just to show it to you. After I cut it out, this is a maple leaf cut out of brass.
Okay.
After I've done that, I would put it on a soft, like a newspaper. This is a very soft type of a magazine.
Mm-hmm.
And I would use this to put in these indentations. Let's see if I can get these right. Here we go. And you can see them on the back too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, and as I'm doing this, you notice that the leaf is naturally bending a little bit and looking much more like a real leaf.
Absolutely.
So once I have the leaf to like this, or if I have these are these little bee bombs, and you to bend these, but my next step is to take and put a stem on them. And we'll take a minute and I'll do that. So I'm going to move these out of the way for right now. They're fine. And I'm going to grab this. And I do sometimes use just a little butane torch is what I'm going to use today. I also have an oxyacetylene torch with a jeweler's handpiece. Okay. This is what a jeweler would use, because I'm doing the same kind of very fine, delicate work that they do, but I'm not going to use that for our demonstration. What I normally do, these are little helping hands that I've bought from one of the dealers that sells them. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to take a piece of brass wire. And again, I buy these, you can get them at hobby stores and so forth. Mm-hmm. Sometimes I use brass. And sometimes I use steel. And I'm going to cut this. Okay. And I'm going to take this. And try to show you how I put this together. I'm going to use this to hold it in place if I can get it lined up right.
No pressure.
Yeah, no, for sure. That's easy for you to say, Kay.
I know.
It's not doing exactly what I wanted to do, but anyway, I'll show you on a toe, because I use exactly the same principle. Normally, actually, what I can do is I can try to use two of these and show you this. I actually have about 8 of these that I use for different things.
I'm sure they come in handy. I mean,
they do. I mean, I can match them up. I can bring this up whatever angle I want.
Yeah.
I can bring this down.
Yeah, I can definitely see how wonderful that works for you.
And line these up. You know, the trick is to getting them in the right angles. Kathy, you can tell me if that looks all right.
Yeah, that looks fine for me.
Okay. And what I do is I will use some liquid flux. And I want to just put a drop exactly where I want it. If I get it in the wrong place, it'll make a mess and go everywhere. So I'm just trying to use it right there. That's the only place I want it. I'm going to put a pair of glasses on because I'm going to be using some flame.
Okay, there we are. We were a little frozen there for a moment. So.
Oh, okay, you got me back?
We're back.
Okay. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to put a little heat here. And a little solder here.
Mm-hmm. Nice.
And you just got to let it cool a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
And what I'll usually do is I'll go back with a little sander and smooth that little edge down a little bit to make it look more blended into the leaf.
Right, right. So. Okay. Dick, I just want to tell you, we have about 10 minutes and I know you wanted to show us the feet.
Yep. I'm going to do that next.
Okay. Well,
all right. So
time then.
All right. Perfect. Perfect.
While you're getting ready, I want to say that anyone can get a hold of you, Dick, at your phone number, right?
Yep, yep.
I'm going to say 610-574-9671.
Correct.
And also they can get in touch with you through your email.
Yep.
And I'm going to say that is D as in David, K as in Kite, D as in David, M as in Mary, Snyder, yep. Snyder. @comcast.net.
Correct. Perfect.
Yep. Okay.
And feel free to reach out, ask me any questions you have. So, all right. This is a foot I made. And I don't know if you can see the detail on it or not.
It is perfect.
It's a piece of brass put together, several pieces. And then I use a two-part epoxy putty that I coat and then allow it to dry. And then I go back in and shape it because I want to make sure I have the little areas underneath that they use for gripping on the branches. Mm-hmm. And I want to make sure I have all the marks in the leg and in the toes themselves. So the goal is when you're doing competitions to try to make them look as close to perfect as you can. This is a pair of feet, as I said, I did for a competition.
Yeah.
And I don't know if you can see them, but they're tiny. Bird feet are absolutely tiny. They're very fine, with the exception of birds of prey. They have big, big toes because that's how they make their living.
Right. You know,
they need those big feet in order to dispatch whatever they catch. So, okay. So here we are at foot time.
Foot time.
And what I'm using is, I'm using, again, a piece of brass. Sometimes I use steel, depending on what I'm making, but more often than not, I just use plain brass. And you can see what I've done is I've done three cuts. I've done three pieces of brass, and what I normally do is I normally will buy a pair of cast feet. Beginning carvers can use them, even for your competitions. There's a gentleman who's for about 40 years has been, he's got a license from the government. When a bird dies, he can get the feet from the deceased bird, and he can use them to make casts.
Wow.
And then they use pewter to make the cast feet. And he sells those. So I usually use those as a reference for how big the feet are going to be for a bird. Now, you have to remember that birds are not always the exact same sizes in every part of the country. So you may want to adjust the size a little bit to where the area where you're from. So, all right. What I've done is I've taken a piece of brass and I've sharpened it. And I just use a bit to sharpen a point on it. And then what I've done, a pair of pliers. What I've done is I've taken that and I've bent it back and then taken the end and bent it forward. And what I'm trying to do is to get it to look as much like a talon as I can. Now, I have to do that. Again, you have to know how the feet are and how they work. I have their four toes. The back toe is number one. The inside toe is number two. The long center toe is number three. And then the outside toe is number four. And they have different amounts of joints. The back toe has one joint, and it can only grab here at the back. That's all it can move. The only joint that moves is the back joint. Okay. The inside has two joints, the long has three, and so forth. And what I've done with this foot is I've gone back in order to bend it, and I've put a cut underneath the toe. And again, I can show you that in just a minute. We'll put this toe together and I'll show you how this works.
Okay. Well, we are winding down here, Dick. So I want to take a moment, you know.
Okay.
And okay. Talk about you a little bit, you know, because you're way too humble. We saw all those ribbons, you know, hanging on your door there. And
well, you know what, as I said, I do quite a few competitions, and the local competitions I do very, very well. When I go down to the World Show, I'm in the advanced category, which is the second from the top, and it's a much more humbling experience there. There are some absolutely amazing artists, and they actually really come from all over the world. There are people there from Southeast Asia, from England, from Britain. We have a couple of competitors that come from Russia. Uh-huh. They come literally from all over the world, and some of them just are very, very amazing artists, and really, you really have to bring your A game to compete against them. So,
well, I mean, I'm sure I got goosebumps when you were just telling me that. You know? And you made me want to go there to the.
Okay. Well, you know what? I would encourage anybody to go. It's the last weekend in April. It's in the Convention Center in Ocean City, Maryland. It's a beautiful venue. You're right across the street from the ocean. And it's a great time to be there in Ocean City. The weather is just starting to get nice. So if somebody's got a chance, you'd absolutely love going down there and seeing the pieces in competition. There'll be several hundred pieces in competition. There's a class for kids. There is a novice class, an intermediate class, an advanced class, and then the world class.
Mm-hmm. So, and you judge some of the younger, you judge the...
I do. I have judged novice class and then the kids classes. I've been asked to judge down there. And I, like I said, I'm very proud of being able to judge down there. And I learn so much from judging with other people. Mm-hmm. You know, particularly I've judged with, you know, several world champions. And you just learn so much from them and just talking to them and how they're looking at something. You know, it isn't just the bird that you're carving. It's putting them in the right habitat. Mm-hmm. And the hardest part for me is the composition, is making that bird look real in a natural habitat and showing the bird off so it becomes the focal point of the carving. That's, as I said, the challenge.
Dick, it has been so nice being in your studio today. I know you've done an amazing job here today.
Thank you, Kay.
You have also donated this beautiful bird that I keep looking at here. Okay.
Yep.
And you've donated that to BCTV for their Oktoberfest auction. So it's going to be on their website, you know, in October when they start their Oktoberfest auction. And we thank you so much for that. Do you want to show us those feet quick, or are we
well,
good?
Well, I'm just going to show you how I put it together.
Okay.
And then what I would do is I would put a drop of this liquid solder on there.
Okay.
And just, again, or flux, excuse me. And then I would put my solder on and heat it up and just put it together.
Okay. Well, like I said, Dick, you have done an amazing job here for us today.
Thank you.
For being here. So I'm going to say thank you so much. And Kathy, thank you for being the camera person. And I'm going to say we'll see you next time on BCTV, Your Berks Craftsmen. Thanks for being here today.
Your Berks Craftsmen on BCTV is supported by the Kutztown Folk Festival and by the Reading Berks Guild of Craftsmen. BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.